you are going to receive a real blessing. Larren Cole is a gentleman. He's an evangelist, and he's somebody that we like to call the Better Life Evangelist, because as he goes to other churches, he promotes a better life as our evangelist. He's also, as I mentioned earlier, the gentleman who put together the documentary, The Seventh-Day Beavers. He assured me backstage that he has not observed any legalist beavers. So praise the Lord for that, right? Anyway, Larren Cole, come out and give us a blessing tonight.
Good afternoon. And happy Sabbath afternoon. Did I hear him say legalistic beavers? And I told him that these beavers, I didn't say that they were keeping the Sabbath. They're actually, I never observed them coming out of their lodge on Saturdays. And so that's just strictly a scientific study, an observational study. And so we were blessed to be involved in that. So it's a real blessing to be here at the Better Life TV camp meeting. As the Better Life TV evangelist, I wear that badge with pride, and in a good way, a good spiritual pride. It's great to work with Better Life TV. Also, you probably have seen, many of you probably have seen the Seventh-day Beavers on Better Life TV, and that particular documentary has been going around on other networks around the world, all over the world, South America, Europe, New Zealand, Australia, and of course all over North America, and it's been a real blessing. Many people are ordering these DVDs, our Seventh-day Beaver DVDs, by the hundreds, and using them as sharing tools, and we'll have some of those stacks of sharing DVDs on our table tonight after the sun goes down, and I hope those can be a blessing to you as well as they have been a blessing to many other people. So that being said, we will step into our message. Our message here tonight, or this afternoon, is called The SDA Laborers Are Few, right? The SDA Laborers Are Few. What I want to do is I want to share seven encouraging, awesome principles for evangelism. Now, these awesome little principles for evangelism have been really sort of help, they sort of help remove the stigma around the E word, the evangelistic word, for many of us in many of the churches that I've been working with in evangelism. So the Seventh-day Adventists, the SDA laborers, are indeed few. Now that comes from a Bible text, right? That comes from Jesus. Jesus is the one who told us that the laborers are few. And you can see I added the SDA laborers are few. Now that's true, isn't it? Right? If it's true that the laborers are few, it's also true that the SDA, or the Seventh-day Adventists, laborers are few. Now, why would it be a problem if the laborers are few? Why does that present a problem? Yeah, that's exactly, because the part before that verse in Luke 10, verse 2, says that the harvest is great, right? So that is a problem. That comes from Jesus, Luke 10, 2. It's also in Matthew. And what it is really saying, for you economists, is that there is a supply and demand imbalance, right? Is that right? A supply and demand imbalance. Now, what happens when the demand for something is high and the supply is low? What happens to the price of that product? Yeah, it goes up, right? The price goes up. There's a huge demand for something, and there's a low supply for something. It's good if you're building something, selling something, a service, if the demand is high but the product is low in accessibility, boy, the price goes up. Now, I remember when I went back to college at an older age, I went back to Loma Linda University, and I went into what I thought would be a job that would actually make some money. And it was physical therapy. I knew somebody talked me into going to school in physical therapy. And the reason was because I realized that the demand for physical therapists was, and still is, kind of high. I've retired since, by the way, so don't ask me questions about PT. I always get that. I retired in 2002, and I forgot everything I knew, almost everything. I remember how to walk, but that's about it. But I went back because I realized, now, I'm going to pick this major because I want to get out and actually have a job that is in demand. Amen? Right? And I noticed now, when I was getting my prerequisites, I noticed a lot of the young students, some of the younger students that were in these public colleges that I was going to get my prereqs, I noticed a lot of them were majoring in things like psychology, which is an absolutely fascinating study, right? Psychology, I remember I took developmental psych, I took general psych, and these studies were just, I mean, they're just fun to study. And a lot of people were so fascinated by this, some of the younger people, that they actually decided to major in psychology. And you know what? I looked on a little survey. It's called the CBS Money Watch Survey, and they surveyed the top 25 majors with the highest unemployment rate. What do you suppose was on the number one of that list? General psychologist. You know, that's not to say that psychology is a bad field. My niece happens to be a psychologist. She got her master's. She actually got a job, which was just, we thought, wow. She just graduated and then got a job. But it turns out that her job is highly dangerous. She has to counsel these young, troubled teens. And so what she does, she has her desk sort of positioned right by the door, right by the exit, blocking the, not the victim, what do you want to call the customer, what is a customer, patient, client, amen. So the client, and so because she's often attacked by the, so anyway, that explains how she got her job so easily, but she's, I'm sure she's very, really good at it. But I chose a major because the high demand, right? This is exactly what's going on in Luke 10, verse 2. The harvest is great, but the supply, the laborers, they're few. And what it is, I think what Jesus is really doing here, he's really posting a job posting, right? Has anyone ever looked in the classifieds for jobs? This is actually a job posting, right? The harvest is great, Jesus says, but the laborers are few. In other words, there's lots of work, right? But there's few workers. So SDA laborers who are looking for a job, the market is wide open. And guess what? The pay is kind of, you know, out of this world, right? The retirement plan, at least, is out of this world, right? You may not think it pays all that well, and I can tell you, you know, living hand-to-mouth in full-time ministry, that it's kind of nice living hand-to-mouth, God's hand, my mouth, you know, we live that way. But Jesus is saying, well, I'm looking for laborers, and there's a job market wide open here. You go into this field, guess what? You got a job. Now, the official mission statement of the Seventh-day Adventist Church reads like a, just is beautiful. It's to make disciples of all people and communicate the everlasting gospel. Now that's a great mission statement, isn't it? And I, in our ministry, Desire Media, we sort of adopted the same mission statement. Just one of, we're a supporting ministry of this particular organization, and so our mission statement, to make disciples of all people and communicate the everlasting gospel. Now, where does that phrase come from, the everlasting gospel? Only one place in the Bible, Revelation 14:6, right? I saw an angel coming, flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel. That's the only place you see it in the Bible. And so that's Revelation 14, our three angels message. And so our evangelistic meetings and most other evangelistic meetings in the Adventist church are predicated on Revelation 14, right? So the methodology of the mission statement in the Adventist church is this. It's through preaching, teaching, healing, discipling, and if you were to condense those four words into one word that starts with a big E, what would that word be? In a word, evangelism, right? Now the Bible has lots of stories of evangelism, amen? Lots of stories where God's people are seeking to save lost humankind, right? And some are successful, and some not so successful. I'm thinking in the Old Testament of a meeting that, in terms of numbers at least, a crusade, in terms of numbers at least, was sort of not so successful. Can you think of one? Yeah, here's a picture. This picture conjures up the story of Noah, right? Now, how long was Noah's evangelistic crusade? 120 years. Now, that's a long one. Now, we used to have really long meetings when I was a kid. I remember Joe Cruz coming to town in Bakersfield, and his meetings were, I don't know, how long were those meetings? They were long, right? And like 8 weeks, you know, and but the atmosphere of evangelism was just amazing, and the you know, it was just everybody's on fire, and it goes and goes and goes, and after a while, you know, some of the saints get kind of tired, and but here we have Noah, 120 years. Now, in that 120 years, how many baptisms did Noah have? Someone said eight. Yeah. Eight, yeah, wow. You know, now if we were at the conference office and looking at that on the report sheet here, we'd say, 120 years, eight baptisms. Not so good, right? And some people have estimated that the population of the earth was about 1 billion. Now, I've actually had, there's several studies. The Bible science guy, he did a little calculation. He calculated there was 10 trillion people by the time the flood came. I didn't think that, but he had all the numbers. You can look this up online, actually. Tom Pickens calculated 10 billion. My Bible students' comments, they were 801 billion. BibleTruth.org says only 235 million. And so a lot of Adventists, though, have expected, well, probably about a billion. So we have eight out of a billion. Because he did preach to the whole world, didn't he? That's why it took so long, 120 years of building a boat on dry land. Now, would we say that Noah failed because of these low numbers? Absolutely no. Big N-O, no. Which brings out a principle, not one of the seven, but this is actually a principle. One of the principles, the encouraging principles for evangelism is that the lost must be preached to. Did you know that? Before God could bring a flood and destroy everybody, he has to preach to the lost, right? He can't blindside them. So encouraging principle, this is not on the list of seven, but it's an encouraging principle to know that when you preach, you've got to preach to the lost as well as the saved, right? And that's bore out in the story of Noah. So Noah's was successful in that his message reached the entire world. And so that is an amazing success. And sometimes our numbers are low, right? Sometimes we hold a meeting and, you know, the numbers are not all that great. And which brings us to evangelism principle number one, which is this. Our job, and take a picture, if you got your little phones out, you can take a picture of that, a screenshot of that. This is important. This is encouraging to know that our job is to proclaim and invite, but not to what? Persuade and convince, right? Now, whose job is it to persuade and convince? That's the Holy Spirit, right? The Bible tells us, Jesus says, red letters, he says in John 16, verse 8, it says, when he, the Holy Spirit, comes, he will convict the world of sin, right? Right? And sometimes we think that it's our job to persuade and convince, right? How many of you have read the book by Ron Rarick called Iceman? Iceman, that was a story. Has anyone seen the book, Iceman? Yeah, Ron Rarick was a hitman for the mafia. And he got caught. The last crime that he committed was to hijack an airline for $1 million, got caught, went sent to jail, I think for life. And during his time in jail, he found Jesus through the prison ministry system, praised the Lord, and then he found the Lord, got on fire, and then miracle of miracles, he was paroled and released from jail after just 10 years. And he was so on fire, he went to like the ABC bookstore, I guess, and he got some tracts and went out to the park and started to share Jesus, right? And now, what do you suppose a requirement, as far as a job description requirement, would it take for you to get a job as mafia hitman? What would that require? Now I'm too skinny. And I'm not, well, you know, maybe. But what do you suppose it was that got him that job in the first place? He's a big guy, you know. He's big and he's intimidating. He's a hitman, right? This is a guy that rubs people out, right? So Ron Rarick was all of that, big and intimidating and a little short of the fuse, right? He's out there sharing the gospel. People were taking his tracks. But he noticed in this book, you can read about it, he noticed that many people were, they were taking this track, oh, thank you, and then they would take a few steps, and when he wasn't looking, they'd just go by the trash can and just sort of drop it in the trash can. And in his book, he says, this fried Ron, this fried him. And so finally, about the time he's really kind of upset, a young college-age young man, and sometimes college-age young men, I've been there, can kind of put their mouth in gear before their brain actually does the what it's supposed to do and sort of regulate that. So he hands this guy a tract. The guy grabs the tract, takes two steps, according to the book, two steps, wads it, and throws it on the ground. And that's when Ron said, Ron, snap. I snapped. He got up, grabbed the guy by the collar, and said, hey, fella, is that all a message from Jesus means to you? And the guy turns around to see what kind of Jesus freak has just assaulted him. And he looks up, and it's Ron Rurick, you know, this big guy, this mafia. He had no idea this was a mafia hitman. He thought he was a tame, Bible-thumping Jesus kind of guy, you know. And so he turns around, and the book says he attempted to take a stand. He says, well, it just so happens I don't believe in God. I don't think there is a God. And Ron Rurick says, you know, well, there just so happens there is a God, and he deserves your respect. And he told the guy, now, I want you to bend down there and pick that up and read it, right? And the guy attempted to make a stand in the book. You can read about this. This is an amazing testimony. So the guy took a stand. He refused. He says, I don't want to. So Ron Rurick, this is no kidding, he picks the guy up and slams against the tree and gives him a little slap across the chops there and says, now, I want you to pick it up, get down on your knees. We're going to give our heart to Jesus right now. Finally, the boy complied, and Ron Rurick had himself his first convert, right? Right? Who knows? This guy might be in heaven. It might have been just what he needed. You know, sometimes I want to do that sometimes to people, but, you know, rejection, of course, is a big part of evangelism, right? But remember, the lost have got to be preached to. And so it is our job to just proclaim and invite to be Christ-like, and it's the Holy Spirit's job to persuade. Let him do that job. We were holding a series of meetings in a little town some years ago, and there was a lady coming to our meetings, and she was coming, and when she showed up, now, her name was Gail, and Gail had a lot of different body piercings and things, you know, hanging all over her ears and chains going from one thing to the other, and she was, of course, as welcome as can be, amen? And we were glad she was there. She was absorbing everything. About seven meetings into the series, she came to a meeting and she had none of that stuff on. All of a sudden, it was just off. It had never been off before. It was off. And I'm kind of nosy, a nosy evangelist, you might call me. And I said, hey, Gail, where's all the stuff, you know? And she said, hey, oh, Larren, let me tell you, this morning when I was having my morning devotions, I was getting dressed, getting ready to get dressed, and the Holy Spirit, I guess it was, just told me, don't put that on. And so I said, really, you think that was the Holy Spirit, huh? She says, yeah. And not only that, I went to pour my morning coffee, and the same voice said, don't drink that. That's not good for you. Now, what was that? What was going on here? You know, we hadn't said a thing about godly living, you know, adornment, you know, or all these things. But the Holy Spirit saw his opening. And it does us really well just to stay out of the Holy Spirit's way, right? We can proclaim and invite, teach. You know, there's a lot of things the Bible says about adornment and healthy food and all those kind of things. We just preach the gospel and invite them, but let the Holy Spirit do that job, amen? Proclaim and invite, Holy Spirit, persuade and convince, and he's an expert at that. All right, so one of the most successful evangelistic series in the Old Testament would be, boy, you guys are right with me. You must see the slides up there. Jonah, right? Jonah 1:1, you can read about this amazing crusade that Jonah has, right? Okay, Jonah 1:1, it says, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, verse 2, chapter 1, verse 2, it says, arise, Jonah, and go to Hawaii. You know, that's what I always imagine when I'm getting a call from a church. Oh, wouldn't it be nice if they'd stop calling from North Dakota in the dead of winter or Alaska? Why don't they call in the summer, right? Or the Sun Belt in the middle of the winter? It's never that way. And so it wasn't a call to Hawaii. They say a call to Hawaii is a call from God. You don't have to pray about it. It's a yes, right? You know, usually when someone calls, you've got to pray about that and say, Lord, is this a call from you? But they say when Hawaii calls, you can bypass that hope now. I'm just kidding. Arise and go to some place in Syria. Are you serious? Serious? Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. Now, why send Jonah to this horrible, godless place in Syria? Well, that brings us to important evangelism principle number two, which is, there it is, Jesus, guess what? Jesus knows something, right? He knows where the harvest is. Sometimes we think we know where the harvest is, right? I think we should have a meeting over here. I think we should do this particular outreach. I think over here would be just the right thing to do. But guess what? Jesus knows exactly where the harvest is. Amen? Right? And he proves that. Remember after the resurrection, John 21 verse 6, the disciples had been fishing all night, right? And what does fishing spiritually symbolize? Looking for souls, right? Fish represent souls spiritually. Jesus made that abundantly clear. All right, so they're fishing all night, caught nothing. This guy on the shore, it's Jesus. They didn't know it. Jesus says, cast your net on the other side of the boat, and guess what? I see fish over there, right? You know, they're not over there. They're over there, right? Jesus knows exactly where the souls that are ripe for harvest are. How encouraging is that? If we could ask Jesus where we should cast our nets, Jesus will tell us where to cast the nets. Important principle number two, Jesus knows where the harvest is. But Jonah, the Bible says, but Jonah, he rose to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. Now, what was wrong, Jonah, with just saying no thank you, right? I'll wait for a call to Hawaii. What was wrong with the no? What Jonah was doing here is what lots of us do when we get a call for outreach, for some sort of little project, for community service. What we do sometimes is make ourselves unavailable. And that's what Jonah was doing, right? He's going the wrong way. He went to Tarshish instead of Nineveh. He's going the wrong way. He's from Joppa to Tarshish. That's the wrong way. And what Jonah was doing is making himself unavailable. Now, do we ever do that? Not you Better Life TV people, no. But a lot of us do. I mean, I probably have too. Gone the wrong way. How about when the pastor asks us to do something like this? It's time to go door to door in the community, right? Do some of us say, oh boy, you know what? And I've seen it over and over. I've probably done it myself. Actually, I like going door to door. It's just that there's not a lot of people to go. It's good to go at least with two people. But while most people won't show up for such an outreach event, others object. Have you seen that in some of our churches? It's time to do some sort of outreach. It's time to plan an evangelistic meeting. And while some people don't show up, others actually object. And some of the objections are, well, you know, evangelism just doesn't work here. I was at a church in California. I won't say the name, but the one of the officers in the church says, you know what? We don't want evangelism in our church. And I was like, I almost broke my heart. Really? You don't want evangelism? Well, you're kind of in the wrong church then. Actually, you're in the wrong church. The mission statement is an evangelistic-centered mission statement, right? Others say, well, you know, there's no budget. We just don't have the budget, right? Or they all just leave anyway, right? We baptize them and they're out the door. It's this 3 or 4 months later, they're all gone, right? Others object. Now, Desire of Ages, one of my favorite books, page 535, the author says, when the Lord is about to do a work, Satan moves on somebody to object. Always. You can count on it. Somebody will object when the Lord is about to do a work, right? So when you see that objection coming, you know that the Lord is about to do a work. And some of the best, most successful evangelistic meetings come with some adversity just before the meeting starts. So my advice is don't let yourself become that person who objects. When that temptation comes to object, say, no, thank you. I don't want to be that person that Satan moves upon. Well, instead of doing it the easy way, Jonah decided to do it the hard way, And he went through a sort of a what we call a fish experience, right? What an amazing experience. He decided to do the hard way. He went through the fish experience. And, of course, you know the story, right? He's on the boat going the wrong way. The storm comes, and they realize that this guy is the cause of it. So what should we do? Well, you got to throw me overboard, right? You got to throw me overboard. A fish gets him. And I think that the Lord used that, right? The Lord must have used that. Well, so Jonah decides to go through the fish experience. That brings us to principle number three, which is the work that we fail to do in good times or times of peace will have to be done when? In a time of crisis. Right? Now, that also comes from the spirit of prophecy. And the author goes on to say in volume 5 of the Testimonies, page 463, under the most discouraging and forbidding circumstances. Now, I don't like the sound of that very much, right? I had a leak in our roof not too long ago. I had a leaky roof, you know. And when does it typically leak? When the sun's out? It leaks when it's raining, right? It leaks when it's raining, and that's the time you don't feel like going out there and fixing it. I'll fix it when it stops raining, right? What happens when it stops raining? The sun comes out, and you don't feel like it, and you forget about it, or you don't feel like it. You got other things to do, and then here comes another storm, and oh, no. Under the most forbidding circumstances, the work that we fail to do in good times, we'll have to do in bad times. The work has got to be done, and we've got to do it. And I don't like the sound of that. I like to do it when the sun's shining, right? You've heard the saying, make hay while the sun shines. Amen. And that's what Jonah did. He chose to do it the hard way. Jonah 3, we'll skip forward to Jonah 3, verses 4 and 5. The Bible tells us, now Jonah, he entered the city, and he cried, yet 40 days, and Nineveh will be overthrown. Now that's his message. That was what the Lord told him to say. But it was effective. Yet 40 days, and Nineveh will be overthrown. And verse 5 says, so the people believed God, and they proclaimed a fast, and they put on sackcloth from the greatest of them, even to the least of them, right? So how successful is that? So Jonah, all he says, hey, God's going to destroy your city in 40 days. All right, message over. That was his message. What a doom-filled message. We always often look at things like that and say, be positive, you know? But when the house is burning, I mean, what do you do? You gotta tell them to get out, right? This place is going to be overthrown in 40 days. But the Bible says, how did they react? Well, they fasted, they put on sackcloth, all of them, from the greatest all the way to the least. And the reason they did that was, of course, because Jonah was a charismatic and he was so sincere in his delivery. Amen? Was that right? Was that the reason? No, he was reluctant. This was a reluctant prophet, reluctant evangelism. Now, that brings us to principle number four, which is you don't have to. Now, this is so important because I camp on this one. You don't need to be a gifted speaker to win souls. Did anybody know that? Did you know that? I'm learning this, and because I'll tell you what, I am a clumsy soul winner. My heart's in it, but boy, man, I am just clumsy. I always feel like a fish out of water, but I just go forward, and I just love what I do. But I know that I'm clumsy, and God could do so much better with somebody else. But he stuck with me in my little realm of ministry. This is all I have. But you don't need to be a gifted speaker to win souls. Jonah proved that. I heard about a man. He's an illiterate guy, and he was very creative. What he would do, he couldn't read, but he had a Bible, and it was marked with some special text. It was all marked up, like John 3:16, you know, sort of like a little steps to Christ kind of text. He would sit on an airplane, and he would open his Bible to a select text, and he would ask the guy next to him to read it for him. I can't read. Can you please read this for me? All right. They'd pick the Bible up, and they'd read John 3:16, and then he'd go, oh, that sounds beautiful. Could you read one more for me? And he'd open to another text. Could you read this? And they go, okay. And they'd read it. And by after four or five texts, guess what? Something's happening in that guy next to him. And he's starting to feel hope, conversion. And by the end of the plane ride, many of them were praying with this guy, giving their hearts to Jesus, becoming converted because of this creative, illiterate guy. Not charismatic, not gifted, can't even read, but God can use that, right? If you just put your foot forward, God will use that. Now, in Jonah's case, at Nineveh, his crusade in Nineveh, if this was an altar call, he had a 100% conversion rate. A little bit different than Noah, right? 100% of the people would have come forward for Jonah's altar call. Have we ever heard of such a thing, a 100% response? Has that ever happened? We wish it would happen, right? That doesn't always happen, does it? Now, one of our board members, maybe some of you know George White, Pastor George White, retired, but he tells a story of his very first evangelistic crusade. You want to hear it? He's in Reserstown, Maryland, and Reserstown, Maryland, his first pastoring job, his first evangelistic crusade, sent out the handbills, did all the advertising, got everything in order, got the meeting hall all arranged, and opening night, guess how many people showed up? One. No kidding. One person showed up, and nobody from the church showed up. Only one guy from the community. He's it. So here we have Pastor White. We've got the one guy showed up, and so they waited, and nobody showed up. He said, well, I'll be willing to preach and go forward with the meetings if you want to stay. Do you want to? And the guy said, well, that's what I'm here for. Yeah, let's do it. And he said, well, you run the projector, and I'll preach, right? So now the guy has to come. He's a projectionist. He said, he was my projectionist. You know, back in the old days, we don't have PowerPoint. We had projectors, you know. And so night after night, the guy showed up every night. The last meeting, that's the altar call, the baptism call. Would you like to get baptized? The guy said, yes, I would. And so when he filled out his report and sent it to the Chesapeake Conference, they had a little form in those days that said, what percentage of the community attendees were baptized? And he wrote in one, true story, 100% were baptized. Sent it in, President Cyril Miller, anybody heard that name? That was the president of the Chesapeake Conference at the time, Cyril Miller. How many have heard of Cyril Miller? A few of you, yeah. And so they got that report from their new pastor at the research town. They got that and they go, we got to go down and see what's going on there. We've got a real soul winner down there, 100%. Of course, they had a good laugh when they found out it was the one guy. But now, that's no laughing matter for the one guy, though. Amen? That guy is thankful. This guy has an opportunity for life eternal because of this evangelistic crusade. So check out the results. Jonah 3, verse 8, of the results of Jonah's crusade. Verse 8, it says, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn every one from his evil way. Now that is a conversion, isn't it? That's the response that God is looking for, right? Right? Let every man turn. This is the king talking to all his people in his kingdom. He says, let's all cry to God, and let's all turn from his evil way. And that brings us to important evangelistic principle number 5, which is, it says, true evangelism calls people to turn from sin and turn to Christ, right? That's exactly what evangelism is for. It's not for teaching people how to get rich. It's not for entertaining people, with music. Music is beautiful and all those things are beautiful, but it's primarily not just to grow in numbers. It's primarily to turn people from their sins and to Jesus Christ, right? All right, so that's principle number 5. Now, some of the most successful evangelistic work and crusades in the New Testament, Acts chapter 1 and 2, we see the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 1, verse 4, the Bible tells us, and being assembled together with Jesus, with the disciples, Jesus commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but to, a really hard thing to do for a lot of us anxious people, but to wait, right? How do you like to hurry up and wait, right? Here they are praying for 10 days, and Jesus says, now don't leave. I want you to go to Jerusalem. I want you to stay there and wait for what? The promise of the Father, which is the Holy Spirit. So now that is very important. Now, what were the results of them waiting for the Holy Spirit to be poured out? What were the results? Yeah, 3,000 converted in a day, and later on 5,000 more. Incidentally, if you look at the statistics, now the Seventh-day Adventist Church now is baptizing, last I checked, over 3,000 a day, which is also a prophetic sign of the end of time. So the results of listening to the Holy Spirit, phenomenal, right? Which brings us to principle number 6, which is never, right? What word did I use? Never attempt to work without the Holy Spirit, right? How many of you remember, are old enough to remember that American Express commercial? Never leave home. Yeah, never leave home without it. That was a great advertising slogan, wasn't it? Never leave home without it. The same applies to evangelism and the Holy Spirit. Never leave home without the Holy Spirit. Never attempt to work without the Holy Spirit. Why? Well, this is God's work, not my work. This is God's work, and we need His direction. And His appointed director is the Holy Spirit. Never leave home without it. The Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit is the one that equips us with special gifts. You read about those gifts, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the much-needed gifts, as Paul puts it. These are needed gifts for the church, equipping them for evangelism. And then back to Acts chapter 1, verse 13, it says, they went in to an upper room, all of them, the apostles, the 11, and then now 12, they got one more, and 120 of them. And it says that all of these continued with one accord, not a Honda Accord, but one accord, that means in unity, right, in prayer and supplication. They're all in one accord. Now, that word I would use is unity, right? That's a very important principle, which is number 7, our last principle for today. I've got many more principles that we share, but I just want to share these 7, which number 7 is, now, the best results in evangelism are achieved by working in, this makes common sense, doesn't it? It's not that when you work in unity, and when I try to go out like Mr. Rambo and be the lone soul winner, super soul winner, here I go by myself, you know, mighty soul winner, ripping off my shirt and showing the big S for soul winner, I'll just flop. I may win somebody to an opinion or something, but it's not going to be the way the Lord would have it. Best results are, and I can tell you from experience, that when a church is unified and the church is ripe for a harvest, that the Lord will bring people to that church. It's just like it's almost like a magic trick. The Lord will bring, to a unified church, the Lord will bring people. When we work in unity, when we work together in unity, we have our best results. I remember taking a prerequisite in college when I was going to go back to college. One of the classes I had to take was a golf class. I took golf from Crafton Hills College in Yucaipa. And it was great. We had this golf course. It was all ours. It was $10 for the whole course. That's what California university colleges were for these colleges. $10 a unit. It was one unit. $10. I get this whole golf course. And an instructor, all the students. One of the things the instructor would have us do, he would have us go to the driving range. We'd all have a bucket of balls. We'd all line up, about 30 or 40 of us, all line up on the driving range, and we'd dump our balls out there, and we'd start driving the balls out in this field. And after about 10 minutes, the field was what color? It was white. It was like, wow. And then after 15 minutes of driving the balls, the instructor would say, all right, now, class, it's time to get out there and get those balls and do it again. The first time he said that, we looked at him and said, get the balls? I'm like, don't you have a machine? And he says, no. He said, and he told us how to do it. What you do is you stand in your little 3-foot sphere of the field, and everybody stay in your 3-foot and just walk by and pick up the balls in your area. And so we did that, and guess what? It was like 2 minutes. We had the whole place cleaned up. And when we worked in unity, We got it done in 2 or 3 minutes. It seemed impossible until he told us how to work in unity. Amen? So the best results achieved through working in unity. Jesus tells us, he says, you are the light of the five-letter word, starts with the W, the world. That's a big place, isn't it? He says, go ye into all the, how would we go into the world? How will we light the world unless we work together, right? Unless we are working together. It's a big demographic place, the world. The world is best lighted with the gospel truth when we work together. My dad gave me the blessed privilege when I was a little boy, just a wee little lad, of holding the flashlight for him while he worked on the truck. I thought that was great. Dad called me out of the house. Son, can you come hold the flashlight? Boy, that felt good. I'm going to go out there and help Dad fix the car. You know, shade tree mechanic Dad, open up the hood. Now, he handed me the flashlight, but he didn't give me any instructions how to do it. You know, it should be a simple job, he figured, but I'm a little boy, and I'm not the smartest little boy. And so he handed me the flashlight, and I had a dilemma. I didn't know whether to shine the light on his eyeballs or his hands. And so I'm thinking, I don't want to mess this up, so I hope I make the right decision. I chose the eyes, and I'm shining, and my dad's like, oh. He says, and he didn't say anything. He just grabbed the light and shined it down on here. Okay, down there. That's, mistake. Number one. I had trouble with that, right? And so when we work as a church kind of separately, what we do is the same thing. We kind of shine our light ineffectively. Amen? On the day of Pentecost, when they worked in unity, guess what happened, right? Amazing results. We see it in evangelism over and over. And on the day of Pentecost, miracles were wrought. You know, God poured out his Holy Spirit, and sure enough, the gift of tongues, in this case, was poured out miracles. I remember holding another meeting. We had some meetings in the Gulf States years ago, and one of the nightly meetings, about 5 or 6 hours from one of the nightly meetings, I had a little accident. I was riding motorcycles with my son, and we accidentally ran into each other. He ran into me, actually. You know, he wasn't looking. We were playing soccer, I'll admit it. We were playing soccer with the motorcycles. I'm on a two-wheeler, he's on a big four-wheeler, and he was going for the ball, and he hit me right in the side of my leg. And what happened is it drove the metal foot peg of my motorcycle right into the side of my shin. It just drove it in like a spear, and punctured my jeans into my, and oh, I lost so much blood. I was dizzy, and I was like faint, and but there just so happened to be an ER doctor that was attending our meetings. My wife called him up, says, "Hey, doctor, can you see my husband? It's like he's got this terrible accident." He said, "I'll bring him in." Got me in there. I can't walk on this thing. I'm just like, oh. I come in there. He puts in several stitches. He stitches it up, stuffs the calf muscle back in, stitches it all up, and praise the Lord, he got all the stuff in there. But now I'm in pain, right? And I'm not a quitter. Now, they don't have like backup evangelists, and we don't cancel them. No, never have I canceled a meeting, right? And so I'm thinking, I'm not going to quit, but I don't know how I'm going to do this. I'm going to have to, if they have to carry me up there, I'm going to preach the message, but I'm in pain, and I can't put my weight on it. It hurts to do that, you know? So I get to the meeting that night. The pastor's up front. He's introducing me, and I'm back there just praying. Pastor's praying for the meetings. I'm praying for what to do. You know, what am I going to do? I can't stand on this thing. As soon as the pastor was done, he says, all right, he introduced me. Come on up, Larren. I said, okay, amen, Lord, here it goes. I stood up. Guess what happened? All the pain immediately gone. Had absolutely no pain, and I was just, wow. And I walked down there, it's just like normal gait. This is amazing. I walked up there, and I preached the message, not a single stitch of pain, answered some questions. We prayed afterwards, shook some hands, and just as I walked out the door, guess what happened? All the pain came back, and oh. Now, the next night, same thing happened. I'm praying. Pastor introduces me. Pain goes away. And guess what? I preached a little longer that time, right? I said, let's answer some more questions. You know, let's don't be so hasty to go home today. And that happened night after night. And miracles. You know, God is in this work, by the way. He is in this work. You know, the formula for eternal life. It's given to us. Jesus tells us. It's John 17, verse 3. You know it, right? This is life eternal. And what is it? That you should know God and Jesus Christ, whom he has sent. The formula for eternal life is knowing Jesus. Knowing God the Father and knowing Jesus, whom God has sent. Now, what's one of the best ways to get to know somebody? Spend time with them. And one of the best ways to spend quality time is to work with somebody. How many of you that have actually punched a clock can attest to that? That when you work together with somebody, you really get to know them. You get to know all their bad things. You know, I worked in rehab. We worked with OT and speech and PT, and we worked on a patient, a common cause, and I really got to know my coworkers only because I worked with them. And you, all of you who have punched a clock, you work with somebody, you work on a project together, you really get to know that person, and you get to know all about, you know them because you work with them. The best way to get to know Jesus is through working with him, right? Jesus has a job for each one of us. He's got a job for you. He says that the harvest, it is great, but the problem, laborers are few. How many of you found these seven principles, seven and a half, how many of you found these encouraging? Are these encouraging? To me, they are amazingly encouraging. And how many of you would like to see the harvest completed? I want to go home, amen? That Jesus has a single, simple message for each one of us. That message is, you are hired. There's a job for you. Now get out there and get to work. Let's pray. Our loving Father in heaven, how grateful we are that you have condescended to call us into the field of labor, laboring for you. The harvest we see is great. The laborers may be clumsy and they may be few, but we are privileged. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be part of this sacred work, to call people into living eternally with us in heaven. What a blessed privilege. Lord, equip each one of us. Inspire each one of us. Use each one of us. Use Better Life TV and help us to get this work, this harvest completed so that we can go home. We pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's saints can say, amen.